Do dentists even prescribe gabapentin?
Find out today on Medical History and Mysteries.
To Medical History Mysteries. I'm Dr. Pam Maragliano-Muniz with my partner in crime, Dr. Tom Viola. How are you?
Good, Pam. How are you?
I'm great. So we need to kind of revisit this topic, this elephant in the room, gabapentin. We know that it is kind of a gateway drug, and it's definitely a source for concern, especially with the opioid epidemic that's going on in this world at this time. But do dentists really prescribe it? And if so, why?
So gabapentin belongs to a group of drugs that originally were specified to treat epilepsy. They were considered anticonvulsants, the gabapentinoids. Later, though, however, they were used mostly to treat chronic pain, neuropathic pain specifically, neuropathy. And there's two drugs in the class. There's gabapentin, but there's also pregabalin, which the brand name of which is Lyrica, which a lot of people use Lyrica. However, we never really found a way to use gabapentin or application for gabapentin in dentistry. It's sometimes used. It's sometimes used post-extraction, post-oral surgery to manage pain by being a nerve blocker. And I've seen some dentists and some oral surgeons prescribe gabapentin for that. But it's mostly been used for things like diabetic peripheral neuropathy, postherpetic neuralgia, fibromyalgia, and other types of myofascial pain, pain of unknown origin, and so on. So I don't believe it's prescribed very often in dentistry as well. But at the same time, I've received some questions about it in my lectures for sure.
So I feel like there's two approaches we can take to gabapentin. Obviously, we can contribute to the issue if we choose to prescribe it, or we obviously have patients that are already taking it. So there's concerns there. Let's start with us as prescribers and as healthcare providers. What's a great alternative to gabapentin?
That's the hard part. We really don't have much, okay? Because if we're attempting to treat some type of chronic pain, perhaps maybe trigeminal neuralgia, although it's not indicated for that use. We might be interested in using gabapentin for its nerve blocking effects. Again, as I said, sometimes after oral surgeries or surgeries that were very involved, perhaps. But for simple, you know, non-complicated third molar extractions and those types of things, or oral surgeries that weren't as lengthy as, let's say, a few hours, we do very well with ibuprofen or other NSAIDs and acetaminophen in combination. So we really don't need an alternate to gabapentin in dentistry. But now outside our world, certainly when those patients are dealing with chronic pain, for the longest time, we thought gabapentin would be a good alternative to opioids for managing chronic pain, because opioids basically, you know, shut off the pain mechanism by inhibiting neurotransmitters in the brain and blocking and occupying receptors throughout the body, but mostly in the brain, to produce the feelings of analgesia and euphoria. But unfortunately, the euphoric effects can be somewhat addictive at some point. So, and that's how we got where we are with the opioid epidemic in the US. So if we're not gonna use it for that, then why would we use gabapentin? Okay, well, we might use it, as I said, as a nerve blocker, but we really run out of uses for it in dentistry, because we would use it ultimately, as I said, just for acute inflammatory pain? No. Okay, outside dentistry, chronic pain? Okay, maybe. But then the specter of gabapentin's illicit use became a problem. And so now we run the risk of prescribing gabapentin for what we think are good motives, right? Altruistic as we are. Let's not prescribe an opioid to somebody who's in chronic pain, because we know opioids are addictive with long-term use. Let's prescribe gabapentin, which is a nerve blocking agent, which would be ultimately better. But how do you deal with the abuse of gabapentin? Why would anybody abuse gabapentin? And the answer is because in high doses, gabapentin can cause a euphoric opioid-like effect. It's so popular that at one time I wrote an article for, you know, Dentistry IQ. I think it's been 5 years now. I think it has over 300,000 views. And I think I get hate mail for it at least once a week. People just don't like my take on gabapentin. Some people say, hey, I use it, works great for me. Or, hey, I used it and it was awful and you should talk more about it. And some people hate me because I let the cat out of the bag and their employer read the article. And so they were using gabapentin and abusing gabapentin and still passing their urine test for work because the urine test for their job didn't test for gabapentin. And now it does. Maybe not because they read my article, maybe because they just found out about it. And so that's some of the hate mail I still get. But bottom line is I am not shaken. Why? Because I am here for dental professionals to let you know that if your patient is taking gabapentin for chronic pain, they may not be the best candidate for an opioid, specifically because, again, we're worried about substance use disorder whenever we prescribe an opioid.
Wow, that was a lot. So I'd say, yeah. So as a provider, you know, maybe if there's an alternative, you know, pain method, we should maybe consider exploring it. And obviously, if there's a patient that's currently on gabapentin, and obviously there's, you know, indications for it, and rightfully so, not everybody's taking it as a gateway drug.
Absolutely.
We know as healthcare providers that we need to be cautious about what we prescribe because of it. So certainly it's a cause for concern, not a cause for alarm, but a cause for concern, and certainly not something we need to contribute to. Is that right?
Yep. The number of messages I get about that article is nowhere near the number of views. So I know there are people out there that use gabapentin, use it successfully, and get great pain relief from it. And it's a gift, you know, it's a godsend to them. And I'm happy that they're using gabapentin and using it successfully and getting relief from their pain. Nobody likes to have chronic pain. Nobody likes to live every day with pain. So I am very happy that it's out there, and I'm very happy that people are using it successfully. But, you know, I always want to make sure that I give the audience every possible angle on medications, because you need to be knowledgeable just about everything when it comes to medications to really be able to give your patient not only good quality dental care, but safe quality dental care.
Amen. So thank you for all of that. I think that was a great review and a great rundown on gabapentin and for, you know, what we need to keep an eye out for as dental professionals. So if you have any issues with it, email Tom. I don't want to hear about it.
You know what this is, Pam, right? It's another example of everything we've been talking about. The three questions: what do you take? Why do you take it? And did you take it today? Are there people out there that use gabapentin for epilepsy? I'm sure there are, right? So you've got to be knowledgeable, not just about the medication, but why they're using it as well.
I love that. All right, everybody. We will see you for Medical History Mysteries next week. Have a good one.
Thanks, everybody. Thank you.